Because living with autism basically means you're living with a list of restrictions, such as socializing with people. It's already a very difficult subject as it is. Trying to look off as normal in the outside world, where most of the majority of the population end up judging, is very difficult to manage. And also having constant wants and needs that you need to fulfill, otherwise your day will feel ruined.
And thank you for joining us for another APS Business Talk. I'm Liam Bujaya, Senior CSR Officer at APS Bank. Today, our speaker, Blaine Schembri, will be talking about neurodiversity and employment. He will explore what neurodiversity is and will shed light on the positive contributions that individuals with neurodiverse traits can bring to the workplace. The session will also provide practical information on fostering inclusivity in the workplace and will offer specific recommendations and adjustments that can be implemented to create a more accommodating environment for a neurodiverse workforce. The talk aims to empower employers and colleagues to create an inclusive workplace culture, where individuals with diverse neurological profiles feel valued, understood, and comfortable. Blaine Schembri, our speaker for today, was diagnosed with autism since childhood. He has worked in the disability sector for over 11 years, contributing to disability awareness meetings, public speaking for people within the autism spectrum, and media interviews. He joined the Commission for the Rights of Persons with Disability, CRPD, last year, with the Disability Equality Training Group to continue promoting awareness. Before we start the presentation, I introduce Christine Mifsud, who is a disability equality trainer and assistant manager at CRPD, who is going to give us a brief overview of what CRPD does to help make multi-society a more inclusive one. Christine, I hand over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Leanne. Welcome, everybody. Hope you will find our business talk interesting. CRPD is the Commission for the Rights of Persons with Disability. We are the monitoring and regulatory body when it comes to implementing legislation on our islands related to disability issues. We fight against discrimination on basis of disability. The CRPD has different roles in our society and on our Maltese island. First of all, as I mentioned, it is the independent mechanism which has to implement the United Nations Convention. We work under the Ministry for the Voluntary Sector, Inclusion and Consumer Rights. We also follow the national disability strategies, which are created by the Directorate for Disability Issues. The main service providers in Malta are Agencia Support, because many people think that we are the service providers. Our units consists of the services unit, who answer customer care calls and other correspondence. We have the National Registry for people registered with us, and we provide the EU disability card. We have the vetting unit where plans from planning authority come in, and we vet them to make sure they are accessible to all. We also have an investigations unit where we receive complaints related to discrimination on basis of disability. We have the research unit where we see why the legislation is not working in Malta, or if it is working, how we can make it better. We do surveys, we research, and we keep up to date with the United Nations Convention. Then there is also the Disability Equality Training Team. Me and Blaine make part of it, and we raise awareness on different topics related to disability here in Malta and Gozo. We also contribute and collaborate with European and international entities. Now I hand over to Blaine.
Thank you, Christine. Hello, everybody. My name is Blaine. It's a pleasure to meet you all. And on our presentation, we're going to be talking about neurodiversity employment. All right, so let me go ahead and share the screen right here. Give me one sec. So what is neurodiversity employment, maybe ask? Well, basically what it astounds is that we're, let's say in a working environment, when you have lots of people with different skills and abilities, they're all in a good working environment, but they're missing some aspects when it comes to people with disabilities working in that said same working environment. And sometimes they may not be too equipped to handle it. So they've invented something called neurodiversity and employment, which consists of basically hiring employees who have any kind of disability, whether it be physical, intellectual, nonverbal, it can be anything. But what it also means is that most colleagues who are non-disabled can work with disabled people, so they can establish a much more stable, accessible, and much more friendly environment, which also consists of all kinds of diversities in the working space, which obviously in many ways, it's a huge improvement, let's say in the line of employment, which basically gives people with disabilities, such as myself, a chance to expand their skill set and let's say move on to the world and give us some more reasons to seek new career options as well. So let's discuss right here. So we're going to be discussing on these contents. What we have is neurodiversity, like I mentioned before. We have key indicators. We're also going to be talking on the autism etiquette, which is the one that I specialize in. We'll also be mentioning some statistics, and finally, some workplace accommodations. So like I mentioned before, it, what it means is that it consists of intellectual impairments referred to as neurodiversity conditions. But what it also means is that some people have asked, what is this neurodiversity fall under on the all kind of disability category? I say no, mostly on the intellectual side, which it says right here, let's say ADHD or ADD, autism spectrum disorder, even developmental coordination condition, specific learning condition, stereotypic movement condition, and also Tourette syndrome. We'll be discussing those very, very shortly as we go along. So those fit on the category of neurodiversity. Let's say somebody who has a physical impairment does not fall on the neurodiversity, neither someone who is also hard of hearing or loss of sight. They do not fall under the neurotypical category. So what are these, like I mentioned before? Well, it says right here, the ADHD is an attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, which is a neurodevelopmental diagnosis. Let's discuss them all one by one. So what ADHD is, basically, it's categorized in inattention and hyperactivity or impulsivity, which in, let's say, in practical examples, means the brain is working overtime and it's trying to, let's say, get everything done right. But with ADHD, it kind of gives some red flags here and there, and sometimes makes the brain not function very well. Sometimes it makes you either... it can fail to give you close attention. Sometimes it overlooks or misses certain details. Maybe sometimes work becomes inaccurate. They also have difficulty in sustaining attention in tasks or to play activities. As I remained focused during lecture, it can be very difficult. Conversations can be tough to also continue on. And sometimes with lengthy reading, they may have some certain difficulties catching up. And sometimes they do not seem to listen when spoken to directly, or their mind seems elsewhere. You could be having a conversation with a person with ADHD. You may think they're understanding you, but maybe their minds are operating, let's say, from the moon, for example. Everything is hunky-dory, but they're not listening to a word they say. It's actually very, very normal, though. And even sometimes, even in the absence of obvious distractions, they are very easily distracted. You could be having a normal conversation, and let's say you spot a housefly, someone with ADHD will point full attention to it, because let's say in an environment like this, everything is static. When they see a moving object, they basically point towards it because it attracts their attention. Sometimes they're also, they do not seem to follow through certain instructions. They can start tasks, but they quickly lose focus and are easily sidetracked. It's actually very, very common, even with me. Even though I have autism, sometimes it has traits of ADHD. But many times I have lots of lectures to keep up. And in many situations, I lose concentration. And sometimes I just wish I can listen to some music or at least do something fun in the meantime. And when my brain is satisfied, I go back to working on my latest task. They even have some difficulties or going through certain instructions as well. And they also, in organizing certain tasks and activities, sometimes managing sequential tasks, even keeping certain materials, that's another one, such as order belongings in order, having a messy, disorganized work. Even they suffer from poor time management, which is very understandable in their case, because they try to get almost everything done in one day, but sometimes they miss through a few very important ones, and they don't see that time is either passing by, either too slow or too fast in some cases. And sometimes they also fail in meeting certain deadlines and such. Another trait with a person with ADHD, they sometimes lose track, or they lose the things necessary for tasks or activities, such as school materials, pencils, books, tools, wallets, keys, paperwork, eyeglasses, and even sometimes their smartphones and such. And they sometimes often fidget a little bit, or they tap their hands, or they squirm in their seat. Again, it's something very, very common they go through. And also one of the more important ones, and let's say the one that gets overlooked the most, is that they require constant movement. It's in the name, with hyperactivity. They always have to be constantly on the go. Sometimes I also met a few people with ADHD who couldn't stop moving. They need constant energy. They have to burn it. Otherwise, their minds won't be able to function properly. In some cases, also, I know that there are some people with ADHD that they need to do, let's say, 30 minutes of a mandatory workout before their brain starts to kick in, or let's say for them to concentrate to fully on their tasks. If they don't accomplish this particular goal, they will be very slow in their production, and sometimes they go through a few messy steps here and there. It's understandable. And the last one is that they often talk excessively. I know what it means. They like to spam a lot of information just to get every part of their words out, so to make sure they don't miss any certain details, right? Because if they forget, hours later, they will say, I forgot to mention that one particular thing in our conversation, and they keep on going. It's actually kind of quirky. It's a nice character trait in some cases. It can also present some laughs in certain conversations. Now, I'll be also asking a question on the diagnosis, though. For, let's say, for this one in particular, many people have asked me, is there a difference between ADD and ADHD? And yes, there is. ADD and ADHD have many similarities. However, ADHD makes general movement more difficult, since their minds and thought processes are accelerated. So therefore, encouraging them to multitask with heavy restrictions, as it says right there. Now, let's jump into the autism spectrum condition, my style. It's a neurodevelopmental impairment, which also it ranges from having trouble the talking or also discussing certain emotions, little to no eye contact, restricting body language, and a total lack of facial expressions, difficulty in developing, maintaining, and understanding relationships, and even adjusting behavior to suit various social contexts, even to difficulties in sharing imaginative play and also in making friends, which unfortunately it affects their social life severely. Take it from me, and in school, I was very good at my studies, but at making friends, absolute zero chance. I was considered the weird one back in the day. But nowadays, they seem to accept me for who I am. So that's a good sign. And also, additionally, depending on the severity, restricted and repetitive patterns of behavior, interests, and activities. There are also three types of severities. There's a high functioning, which is where I'm in, which means I can do basically most of everything comfortably while also requiring small amounts of help. The middle term, where they require help, but also they fail to do certain common tasks unless they have some help required, such as tying shoelaces, for example. They can have some difficulties managing in that, so they need more than constant help. And sometimes it's just a little bit of emotional support to keep them strong. And also on the severe side, they have much more difficulties in managing in almost everything and need constant 24/7 help. So, but thankfully they have good parents who will give them all the equipment they need on their journey, the right amount of support, and also with the right amount of company to keep their confidence levels up. And also, there's also stereotyped or repetitive motor movements, let's say the use of objects or speech, such as lining up toys or flipping objects, reciting lines of dialogue, for example. Let's say when you're talking to yourself and they say, what is he talking about? Into our minds, or let's say we're reciting some lines from a film we just saw, for example. It stays in our brains and we always go through it because it's a certain line of dialogue that we enjoy. It kind of brings us a little bit of a small amount of joy. And also, they are also requiring of routines, such as extreme distress at small changes as well, difficulties with transitions, rigid thinking patterns, greeting rituals, and sometimes consuming the same daily food every day. And also highly restricted fixated interests that are abnormal in intensity or focus, such as a string attachment with unusual objects, forming a bond with said objects as well, even excessively circumscribed or persuasive interests as well. Let's say you can be, most people would enjoy, let's say, soccer or basketball, baseball. For our turns, maybe we go into a more different source, let's say with media involved, let's say video games or even board games. That's something that we can have a grab on and something that can entertain us as we go along. Or sometimes even a hobby that not everyone enjoys, which also leads us to having many difficulties in making friends because they don't understand what we enjoy and they expect us to understand what they like, not vice versa. Also, with hyper or hyperactivity to sensory input, or unusual interest in sensory aspects of the environment. For example, let's pick apart this room. Sometimes the lights can be too bright, which can make us feel nauseating as well. Maybe the intense use of color can sometimes make us feel disoriented as well. Lots of sharp noises as well. It can disrupt our hearing. Just like I mentioned, we have hypersensitivities to all the five senses. And with too much distractions going on, it can lead to our brain having a very difficult time or a meltdown, which literally restricts our body very severely. And even sometimes touching or even smelling can be very difficult. Let's say the use of sandpaper, maybe we get triggered sometimes by it, or it feels like a very wrong kind of material to lay our hands on and can also lead a trigger to our mind. And even sometimes smelling certain foods or even certain smells, let's say gasoline or let's say soup, something we don't agree on, can sometimes also lead a trigger into my mind. It happens to me. There's a certain food that I can't stand. And whenever I smell it, I just can't seem to function properly. But aside from that, as long as I don't smell every day, I'm all good. And also, we also have difficulties in adapting and even developing new skills. Let's say catching objects, using scissors or cutlery, even handwriting, riding a bike, or even very most commonly participating in sports. Sometimes I also have people asking me, can autism be cured? No, it can't. You can either be diagnosed from birth or it can also be diagnosed later on in life. I was diagnosed at the age of 8. I've met many people, they were diagnosed after the age of 15 or even 21 in some cases. That depends on, let's say, their background with their families, on their history with medical experts and such, or maybe because they were trying to raise their children and they had much more difficult times, let's say, cutting to the conclusion that their child may or may not be autistic. And when hearing it for the first time, it can send some difficult messages for the parents. It's understandable. Because when you're raising an autistic child, it can be a very, very difficult task. But when you put lots of patience into it, you can honestly raise someone with massive potential. Like I always say to all my friends, they have the opportunities, they just need to put patience into it. And out comes the great reward. Next, we have the developmental coordination condition. What it basically is that there are difficulties in manifested as clumsiness, such as dropping or bumping into objects, as well as slowness, and even inaccuracy of performance of motor skills, like I mentioned before, catching objects, scissors, handwriting, even riding bikes, sports. It can be very similar to that, but it doesn't follow in the autistic category. It's a different one, actually. There's less traits with autism with the developmental coordination condition, though. But mostly it consists in difficulties in performing physical tasks, such as an unsteady walk, difficulty going downstairs, dropping objects, running into others, frequent tripping, tying shoes, putting on clothes and other self-care activities, and also performing certain school activities such as writing, coloring, or even using scissors. So basically it feels like a body clumsiness. They have a certain limit to what they can perform on a daily task. And sometimes they need a constant rest to make sure their bodies are in the full concentration mode. If it's pushed over the limit, they may not function very well. It can actually sort of be cured, but it requires a heavy use of special methods and practices to make sure their bodies and their limbs are coordinating perfectly. And if there are some issues along the way, they can also use certain methods to improve the motor skills to make sure they have more accurate way of performing their tasks. So yes, it can be improved over time. Next is specific learning condition. What it amounts to is the basic difficulties in learning and using academic skills, such as someone with the specific learning condition, speaking in an academic form, such as like this, can be very difficult to them. For, let's say they use a more casual tone to their language, or sometimes they even have difficulties spelling difficult words and such. Let's say a scientific term to specific meanings, or even let's say the doctor language as such, when they discuss certain diseases or conditions, something very similar to that. And even inaccurate or slow and effortful word reading, let's say they read single words aloud incorrectly or slowly and even hesitantly, they frequently guess words and even have difficulty sounding out the words. It depends on how the brain continues on with it. And also in difficulty in understanding what it means or what is read. They can, let's say, read a sentence out loud, but they have difficulty in keeping up on what they said. Next, we have the stereotypic movement condition. It's a repetitive movement condition though. So basically there's a repetitive, seamless driven and also apparent purposelessness, motor behavior. Let's say hands shaking or even waving, or the body rocking back and forth, head banging, even self-biting, and also sometimes self-harm. The repetitive motor behavior interferes with the social, academics, or other activities, and it also may result in self-injury. And it's an onset in the early development period. It's not attributable to the physical, physiological effects of a substance or neurological condition, and is better explained by another developmental or the mental disorder though. And next, finally, we have the Tourette syndrome, which is a nervous system condition. It involves basically the body performing certain tics or certain noises sometimes can be uncontrollable. They can be very partial, or they can be very lengthy in some cases. They come at complete random, so they don't know what to expect, which mostly involves in either blinking, sometimes eye rolling, grimacing, shoulder shrugging, jerking of the head or limbs, even jumping, twirling, touching objects or other people, or even forced sounds and vulgar sentences. This can't be cured as far as I know, but lots of people with Tourette syndrome out there, they have found many ways to sort of counteract it, and they also make their lives continue on as well. Now, so those are the orders. And also, now, sometimes they also say, do neurodiversity and employment mix well together? Yes, they do. Because I'll tell you why, because nowadays there's a multitude of individuals with several disabilities, not just neurodiversity, and that there are employed in several sectors in employment. This is made possible through the Lino Spiteri Foundation, which helps people with various disabilities seek employment and integrate them into the working world. People with disabilities are still very capable, and under the right conditions, they can contribute in any sector of the world given on the proper training and guidance. And they also have an impact on the employee as well. Now, there are some barriers that maybe previously have excluded in job seekers from the labor market and are gradually eroded through interventions targeted to maximize an individual's skills and abilities, combined with a focused and personalized job matching process. So this can gradually help out people with disabilities to find the right opinion on, let's say, on finding the right job for them. Now, as for the key indicators we have right here, so we have over 2,240 disabled or vulnerable people participated in the Jobs Plus VAST program, all the way from its launch back into 2016. Whoops, sorry about that. All the way to December 2022, so that's absolutely fantastic. And over 2,000 participants were Maltese, and 200 are ghosted, and so that's fantastic, with the list of the key indicators saying that there's a large number of people already finding great jobs, and also they're having their skills massively improved by them. They also have an impact on the employee and even on the employer, which helps them a ton to basically finding the right career path, and also fostering for an environment that basically enriches their company ethos and reputation. So that's one fantastic. Now, let's get to the nitty-gritty. Let's talk about the autism etiquette. Now, people like us, they're very sensitive in life, and I understand why, but they have a much more difficult time going through life and even developing their skills. So what you basically need is a lot of patience to when interacting with someone like us or when fostering us. We are to be treated well and respected regardless of our age. So there are people out there with autism that their brains are, let's say, half the age. If I'm 28, my mind may be similar to a 17-year-old. When you see someone like me as an adult, proceed to talk to us like an adult, not as a child. But that's a major insult to our intelligence. In some cases, use basic communication. We sometimes have certain difficulties in hearing or understanding phrases, because our brain is working overtime saying, is this sentence correct? Did we get every detail right? And sometimes we have a delayed reaction when continuing a conversation as such. But if we sometimes feel like this sentence is too much, we ask, can you say that again, please? And that's the case. Use a more basic structure for it. It can be a lot more helpful for us to concentrate. And we are sometimes easy to be misguided or confused, even when given proper directions are given with the following process. You can tell us to do steps A, B, and C. Sometimes we mix C, A, and B, but it's understandable. But if you give us, let's say, a live demonstration of what you want us to do with these tasks, that can be very helpful. We are very good copycats, as I actually found out. So if you perform one task, we'll follow through that procedure and we stick to it for the rest of our working hours. And let me tell you, it's very effective. We also sometimes take long to respond in certain conversations, but be patient. Like I also mentioned, our brain is working overtime to make sure we get everything right, because we hate making mistakes. even when I, let's say, writing a lecture, I don't want any grammatical errors, none of that. So I make sure everything is working perfectly. Even when I'm doing a conversation, I want to make sure everything is said right and not said in an awkward way. Also, never tend to raise your voice when communicating. Like I said, our ears are very, very sensitive. Because when someone raises their voice, we assume that they are angry at us. And we misinterpret that as bad behavior. And sometimes can often make us triggered. So no need to raise your voice. We can understand you perfectly. Don't shout at us. Otherwise, we will not coordinate very well. And that sometimes can send our bodies to shiver. Because again, we assume that you are angry at us, not trying to raise your voice. And also, when you see someone with autism or wearing headphones, do not yank it off. As we require full use of the headphones, it can either be blocking noises from the outside world, or we can be hearing essential music, podcasts, or certain sound effects that can calm our minds. When someone takes it off, that's when challenging behavior starts to set in, and it's unfortunate. For our case, when it happens, it can be very, very difficult to manage. I understand that, but in this case, best to just, let's say, wave at us if we're wearing headphones, and we remove them for us. So when we are ready, we take them off and we continue on. Now, on the statistics, at least on the job placement, at least 4% of the persons are placed were persons with registered disabilities. So that's a huge number already. And with the Jobs Plus, it provides specialized services to persons with disability who are seeking employment or who may or not be seeking the alternative to employment. These typically start with an individual assessment to identify any possible training and development opportunities and to optimize the job matching process. Because as we all know, we have a specific set of skills and we need to find the right job that helps us develop those skills. Sometimes there are different kinds of jobs that test new skills. They can be difficult sometimes, but most of the people with disabilities I've met are very, very tenacious, and they're always ready to try out with new sets of skills. So it helps us to find different paths and such. It helps us to develop new ones as we go along. And upon application, the client is referred to as a placement medical officer that assesses the employability of a client within the context of his or her disability. And the person then is referred to occupational therapist who assesses the abilities of the client and suggests the ideal path to employment, such as sheltered, supported, or also mainstream. And also, they can also be given with a job coach to basically help them out on their new search for their employment. Having a job coach can be very, very beneficial. I've been working with the same job coach for quite a while. He's been with me on over a 5 to 6 year journey, and he sees me develop and evolve as we go along. He saw me go from a very shy person to a more confident one, and he's seen me more productive in these latest few years as I also go along. Now in 2022, over 390 medical assessments were carried out and over 151 job seekers were registered disabilities were assessed by Jobs Plus. That's already a very huge number as well. Even also with occupational therapy services, which is basically free, it can also help them out to basically speak out when discussing certain issues and can help them conquer certain barriers that they may also be facing. And over 30 persons had their initial assessment reviewed. Data indicates a steady annual increase within the number of persons with disability placed in employment. And over 308 placements were concluded in 2022. Again, massive number. Now, let's talk about workplace accommodation. So when you have somebody with a disability working in the work environment, you want to have accessibility in that. So let's say a person with a wheelchair cannot access a place that basically has chairs instead of a ramp, or a person who is hard of hearing, have, let's say, megaphones, they may not be able to hear them. So that's inaccessibility. Accessibility basically relies in assistive technologies, such as, let's say, a hearing aid that can, or even a lift that can basically lift anyone with a wheelchair user or with a mobility impairment to help them go to upper levels and such. Even a sensory room, let's say for people like us, where the walls are soundproof, so we can work in a very quiet environment, not have to worry about lots of background noise getting in the way, even tasks that which are adapted to our capabilities. Yes, it's actually very beneficial. You're not gonna instruct a person with a wheelchair user to do physically impossible tasks. They don't fit in there. So you give them, let's say, certain tasks or events to do, which are they are more comfortable and much more accessible, even with their restrictions. Having a building environment has to be accessible for all persons with disabilities, both mobility, mentally, intellectually, and all of the above. And even sometimes dimmable lights will be very beneficial for us. Like I mentioned, we people with autism sometimes find light way too distracting. It can just flux with our mind. So having them give you the option to dim can be very helpful for us. Even a standard color layout, not complex, can be very good. Like I mentioned, color to us can be either way too bright or let's say way too dark for us, or sometimes it can, let's say, trigger something of our past. It's actually very, very difficult to manage. And even guided instructions. So when you're having difficulty doing specific tasks, having someone to guide them on their instructions can be very helpful, since they sometimes require a small amount of help. And even with an inclusive environment in terms of colleague interaction as well. Mixing two types of people together with, let's say, people with disabilities as well, can also lead to lots of diversity and great communication throughout. Even installing lifts or accessible ramps is an excellent idea for persons with physical impairment. An even accessible restroom needs to at least have the following: with enough room for a person with a disability to move about, lots of space so they can either be with their crutches or with a wheelchair. They are more comfortable to at least have enough room to rotate around. So, and also it must include liquid soap or a hand dryer with a sensory that is easily reachable. I'm sure you've seen those kinds of dryers where you place your hand and it starts to shoot hot air. That is very useful for us as well. For some, let's say they don't like the touch of certain materials that we sometimes find it difficult to use. Even an umbrella stand as well, where the wet ones can be hung there to dry, and it minimizes the risk of anyone slipping or getting injured. Let's say someone with crutches may not be able to move enough, so when there's a wet surface, it can lead to some injury, unfortunately. So having a more dry floor is actually very useful for us. Even clean grab rails, as when someone is having a physical impairment or have difficulty maintaining a balance in their legs, for example, could use a bit of surface to rest on instead of relying on hanging on the walls. So a rail can be very useful for them to keep their balance up. Even on the job training and job coaching is also needed, since they're having some difficulties in managing certain events and could use the assistance of a job coach, they can be available for them and they can guide them along in their path as they go along. And also, finally, we have accessible social events where people with disabilities who want to feel a sense of inclusion and being able to enjoy themselves, to have a social life like everyone else. We have spent years trying to be included with society, and because of their past, we are a bit reluctant to it. But thankfully, accessibility and inclusion is getting its word out, and they're starting to accept more and more people of different disabilities. So basically, our time has finally come to shine, and it's time to literally coordinate with the rest of society. And even having flexibility on the job. Let's say flexible hours and such, so spending certain hours in the work environment and also in the home environment to make sure they have maximum comfort as well. So at least they can have certain places where they can be in certain times to make sure they can get their job work perfectly. Or let's say someone like us, we prefer to work in an office rather than a home, so we have full concentration. That's also very useful for us. Even teleworking, one disabled person is also a parent and or needs to have access to therapy at home. Teleworking can be very useful for us. It can also help us reach certain clients in a different way, or at least in a different location. So we don't have to be in the same location to reach those clients. Even can be reached from home, which can also help us approach them more comfortably as well. And finally, the adaptations in the workplace that are required to make the work environment more accessible, such as standalone hardware on desks, it's not centralized. And also these adaptations may be minimal and not expensive, but can aid the person to be more independent and productive. So that's the end of it. There's the contact details. You can contact us on the telephone number or the SMS services. Feel free to use the email here or the Facebook hyperlink to coordinate with us if you have any more questions, and we'd be more than happy to reach you. That is it from my end. Would you like to ask us any questions?
Thank you, Blaine, very much for your insightful presentation. We have received a few questions in the meantime, and I encourage the audience, if they have any more, just to type them in the Q&A section. So our first question, symptoms of ADHD seem to be very similar to people suffering from anxiety. What symptoms would be red lights showing that it is ADHD and not anxiety, please?
Well, and I also suffer from anxiety as well, so I know what it basically is. In ADHD, it's basically trying to get everything done in one go, while anxiety is basically preventing the person from performing said tasks. There is a difference between them, as far as I know. But from what I see, with anxiety, it acts like a huge obstacle. With ADHD, the obstacles are basically what's in your mind, or what you can do, or how it makes you concentrate. But anxiety is basically the perception of the outside world. Let's say a certain crowd of people are giving you judgment. It causes the anxiety to explode. Even, let's say, making one small mistake from work also triggers anxiety and such. It's not related much to ADHD. It's ADHD is losing interest or failing to do certain tasks, mostly because of the attention span. So anxiety basically has to do, let's say, with the mental condition of someone else. Let's say when I'm having too much difficulties in managing on one thing, anxiety will set in. And when I'm having the proper treatment for it, anxiety can go away. ADHD, let's say not distracting myself, it can't be helped. If I can't wake up one day and say, I will not get distracted, because it can lead me to getting distracted, as far as I know. With anxiety, you can have control over it. So that's a great sign. With ADHD, you basically have to live with it, though. It can certainly be managed, though. So that's a green light I can say about it. So that's it for the first question.
Yeah, no, also my type of opinion. this question is more of a diagnosis. For those who have uncertainties, when obviously we were at a younger age, maybe there wasn't this awareness of these neurodiverse conditions. We were taught to be more troublesome than others, more distracted than others. But thankfully nowadays, even at an older age, over 20s, over 30s, any age, if you feel that you might be neurodiverse, you might have more than anxiety, for example, and you would need further support, treatment, therapy, then you could go for an adult assessment, which a therapist can do. You can book this, and you can be diagnosed if you have ADHD or not, even at an older age. Thank you.
Thanks, Christine. So our next question, would like to ask whether a person with autism will eventually be able to improve the person's socializing skills as the person grows up? How difficult is it to live with autism?
Well, in my case, it's very difficult with lots of reasons why. Because living with autism basically means you're living with a list of restrictions, such as socializing with people. It's already a very difficult subject as it is. Trying to look off as normal in the outside world, where most of the majority of the population end up judging, is very difficult to manage. And also having constant wants and needs that you need to fulfill, otherwise your day will feel ruined, such as watching a certain video to lower your stress, or even using sensory toys, let's say a stress ball, or even a handy little device or handheld to relieve your stress, and you constantly need them, while also the rest of society are looking at you, it can be very difficult as well, even trying to manage basic tasks as well, without feeling the pressure, let's say, from overprotective parents and such, or them pressuring you to do certain tasks, activities, or to apply for certain skills where you may not be interested to begin with. It can also lead to lots of stress as well. It feels like our lives are being controlled by people who feel more superior than you, because they say autism can be a barricade to our social lives. But mostly, it's just how most of society sees us. They paint us in a different picture, while in reality, we are nothing like that. They falsely accuse us for being a certain type of people where we are the social outcast, and therefore we do not need this kind of treatment. And in many cases, all we wish to basically do is live a normal life. Living with autism is very, very difficult. Even high functioning, I can tell you, it has a large number of problems, but they can all be managed only with patience and trying your absolute hardest to give it your all. For all my life, I've been living with depression, and it's been very, very difficult. And along with autism, it can crush my spirit. But I wake up every day saying, I can survive this day. Let's do it. And I pass with flying colors for the most part. So there are ways to conquer life with autism. You just need to believe in yourself. That is it.
Thank you, Blaine. So another question. In relation to CRPD, what is being done to prevent the label of the diagnosis to prevent from career advances? Furthermore, those that have been employed in the statistics, what are the most common roles provided?
Those statistics we have taken from the Jobs Plus annual report, which you can also find online in further, obviously we took parts of it. And also from the Lean Hospitality annual report, last year's annual report, those statistics were based on 2022. I don't think they did mention what specialization these people found as jobs from experienced persons within the spectrum, especially all found jobs in either IT and office jobs, most of them. But that is from personal experience, from what we have as CRPD. What was the other question about labeling?
Yes, it's saying what is being done to prevent the label of the diagnosis to prevent from career advancement.
Yes. What we do as CRPD, I think it was about 2 years ago, we held the national conference, which was all about employment with different kinds of disability. We invited stakeholders, amongst them were the central bank, investors, people with companies, banks, also had banks on board. So we could have workshops. These workshops were mixed from people within CRPD, from persons with disabilities all over Malta, since it was the national conference, and we also had these stakeholders on board and policymakers. Our main aim isn't to find jobs for people as if we are some charity model. We do not ask companies to employ someone for charity reasons, sort of, or because they are going to benefit from some kind of incentive. We encourage people through even this disability quality training. This year, we had sessions with the Malta International Airport, MAFRE Insurance, and other private entities, private companies, where they see us, the team, disability quality training team, is made up of people who all have some kind of impairments, and we do tackle issues directly. We're very outspoken. I don't mean blunt, but we do raise some issues which we find on the workplace, and we encourage room for dialogue. We want to know why employers are so afraid to employ someone with disability, especially those which are hidden, including neurodiversity. Do they think the person will not be enough productive enough? Do they think the person will take a lot of sick leave? The person will need days off, the person will not come to work in time, the person will create problems amongst a team, the person would need a one-to-one approach, and you can't afford someone to have to stay with that person, showing them what they need to do. And they open up and they talk freely. So there, when we have that dialogue, there's already a beginning where we can break down these labels, which people with, especially neurodiversity, have been labeled with. We also have the complaints, the investigations units, when we have people who are already in a job to find some kind of issue with their employer, or vice versa, employer with employee, and we mediate. We don't act as the lawyers, we're not a lawyer, but we try to find the best possible compromise so both employer and employee are happy on the workplace.
Thank you, Christine. And yes, I must say that we at APS, we've had this training. It was definitely very insightful and eye-opening. So I encourage companies to enroll and sign up to have it delivered to their staff as well. So the next question, or it's more of a comment. My son was diagnosed with ODD, oppositional defiant disorder. However, the symptoms you mentioned are almost identical, which leads me to use the same tools you suggest to keep a better understanding between us. Having said that, he tends to speak loudly. I don't know if you have any comments about this particular condition.
I'm not too familiar with it in my case. I only read a partial amount of the diagnosis. When it comes to intellectual impairment, they have many similarities. Like how I mentioned before with ADHD, it's also very similar with autism as well. We basically have very, very similar traits. They say it's hard to distinguish between them. What others might tell them, it's hyperactivity, which is the first glance in the impairment. With ODD, I'm not too sure of it though, but again, very, very similar in terms of traits and such. But from what I saw, it's not too great though. I mean, they can also be very managed. I've also known that there are many people who asked me years ago, they also mentioned that someone with mild autism can sometimes live a normal life. I tell them, yes, they can. They absolutely most likely can. The secret is independence and no hand-holding. So if you have overprotective parents who have a tight grip on you, if you're mild and you're understanding that you're living in life in like a bubble, you have the option to seek life at your own pace. I do every day. Every time when I go out, I don't have anyone asking me where I am and what I'm doing. I'm busy exploring the world. I'm discovering new things as I go along. And then maybe one day, maybe the next day, I'll get myself a new house. I'll live by myself. And yes, I can manage. Absolutely everything is manageable from my own sense. If I want help, I ask. And there you have it. I have my answer. Sometimes people always say, let me tell you how to do this. Let me solve this one for you. When that happens, we don't learn anything. You don't give us the option to experiment. When we do it, we learn. We watch someone do it, we're copying them. We're not learning though. So keep that in mind. So let's say, to jump from ODD to a mild autism, living an independent life, it is a small jump, I'll admit. But from what I can tell, even from most research, yes, people like us, we can live a normal life. we need just the right amount of support, the right amount of company, and the right amount of respect and attitude from the rest of society. Thank you.
Thank you, Blaine. So another question, what do you believe helps employers feel more prepared to hire a neurodivergent individual?
Good. Yes, being prepared is the best thing, as Blaine also mentioned. When a person on the spectrum when a person on the spectrum is going to do something new, is going to start a new job, for example, he wants to know how it will be, what it will be about, what the day will look like. As Blaine was saying, once he's prepared, once he has the story of what the day will look like, what he will have to do, some of the tasks he will need to be prepared for, then the person will feel less anxious, will be more communicative, will feel more at ease. Maybe the employer could ask the person to go for a couple of times to the office, spend an hour or two, come and leave when they want to. This will prepare them. I'm not saying when the person is employed, this is before. This will give the person time to get used to the place, the smells, the sounds, the lights. And then there you can start discussing. Not any person is the same. Not everyone is the same. People within the spectrum are all different. They have similarities, but to have different needs. Actually, with every kind of disability. As I said, when you have these meetings where the person can be there, maybe the person has the job coach with him who can assist you as well. I believe a lot in job coaching. Blaine and I'm Blaine's unit leader. We have a very good relationship with friends, but he knows that I need to give him work to do, and he knows we have deadlines. So there, the job coach helped me a lot on how to communicate with Blaine, how to set deadlines. Together, me, myself, and Blaine, we have discussions. When the job coach comes, it comes something like natural. It's not something one should be anxious about, scared of. Or yes, sometimes we have issues, and thanks to this dimension, this dynamic, we sort them out, which is very good. Once the person comes to the place, maybe he starts showing you things that he might not like or which annoy him. For example, beeping sounds, flashing lights. Maybe if you're close to a bathroom, there is the hand dryer going on and off. Clicking of switches, for example, if you're near a bathroom, people might go in and out and go click, 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 click all the time. And the person will tell you, for example, or there's someone with very heavy perfume in the office. When you know these things, which might distract the person or even trigger the person, then together, always with the person being involved, you can find solutions for the best way forward. I think this would really, really help the employer in that sense, that he will know and what he's going to meet with, and also the person who's going to start working there will know what to expect. This is very important. We're not saying, listen, you have a person with disability working with you, put them in cotton wool. Don't give them hard work, because if someone can do hard work, he excels in doing hard work, then he will not be giving them the same opportunity as others. And they might get bored, annoyed, and, you know, start getting restless or going in and out of an office. So the best way, the best practice is to have a trial, to have a job coach to assist, and to be sincere if something doesn't go well, both parties can speak in a safe space. One not being scared of being made redundant just before he started working, and the employer not thinking that he's being framed before even having the chance to getting to know the person.
From your engagement with businesses, do managers have training in understanding and skills in order to support neurodiverse employees?
Then again, as I'm saying, I think we need to have a platform when it comes to creating awareness, when it comes to providing the right kind of knowledge. I think we need to, as a CRPD, as a Lean Hospitality Foundation, as a Jobs Plus, we need to get together and campaign, not just for a seminar, a conference, or for a year or two, but we need to have proper, as you say, proper training for these managers. We need to show them it is available. It costs a ridiculous amount compared to other training. All it does is cover the expenses of transport, basically. And what we really need to do is to show them that it is available, that there is a continuation. You don't go to one place, they tell you one thing, you go to another, they tell you something else, because this confuses persons. It is important when a company, a manager, has a bad experience with someone who's neurodiverse, that they keep in mind, this is a person, this is an individual. It doesn't mean that because that person did not like the job, didn't behave as you wished for, it wasn't that productive, that everyone is like him. So we should give second chances. It's important to invest. We invest so much in so many things. Some of them are useless. Sometimes there is so much funding available on European level, which goes to waste in the sense no one applies for it, where we can be very creative. We can create this platform, and we have to give really good incentives, not promoting abuse in the sense that some people want to employ persons with disability, so they don't get they don't have to pay the compensation fee, we call it, because if you have a 2%, you have to employ 2% of your company. If you have more than 100 employees, 2% have to be persons with disability. That is in our Maltese legislation. From some time ago, it was passed that people who do not have the system going on, they're not employing persons with disability, they have to pay a compensation, we call it. This money goes for coaching, for job coaching. So it does have a proper use, but we would rather the company would have someone employed with it than the company paying a fee or a fine. We don't call it fine, but that's what it is. So it is very important. I think this platform should be there. It should be, as I said, in continuity, one entity working with another. And this training should be, no, I'm not saying obligatory, but as a way to help you to benefit the company, the management, whatever, people should, yes, have disability quality training when employing persons with disability or before employing them. I think it works much better when one is prepared than when one tries to work it out by himself or has to face some consequence or another.
Thank you. So we're asking, we've been asked if there is a good book you would recommend specifically about ADHD. Are you aware if there's any good books you could recommend?
There are a few, but I never got the chance to read any of them. Since I mostly do my research on, let's say, school articles or even some lectures and such. However, to jump to a different category, I heard there's a new book on the autism spectrum that just came out. I think it's called Coloritalautismo, as far as I know. I think it's a newly released book. I haven't got a chance to read it yet, but I haven't heard any reviews out of it as well. But I heard it's a very informative one. Actually, my mother just informed me about it when she was cycling through the channels. She told me, hey, son, look, there's a new book on autism. And I took note of it. Never got a chance to do some research on it. But if I manage to, I'll see what I can find about it. I'll give it a good read. If it's something I recommend, I'm sure. It's not what ADHD, though, but it's kind of close, though.
We'll send you, Leon. We'll send.
We can get back to the person with some recommendations.
There is plenty of material on the topic. There's plenty. To let you know, we followed the DSM-5 here when we were collecting our research. It is the American Psychological Association who do the research. They come up with research on neurodiversity and autism spectrum, and obviously on other even psychosocial impairments. We follow the DSM-5, and we also follow the United Nations Convention when it comes to terminology, definitions, and descriptions.
Perfect. So we have our last question. We've had quite a few comments thanking Blaine and Christine as well for your contributions. So this question states, what is CRPD doing in relation to social entrepreneurship?
As I said, CRPD, we like join in, because when it comes to creating jobs, training for jobs, we are not the persons who offer services, but since we are the policymakers, or making sure that policies are being implemented, obviously we join in when these topics are being discussed. Social entrepreneurship is something new, especially for people with disabilities. We had this issue when it came to being insured, for example, even to own your personal home, to get a loan to own your personal home, let alone being insured for creating a business, for being an entrepreneur. To be an entrepreneur, you might need capital before you obviously start. There we worked even on parliament level, and a bit after COVID, I think the summer after COVID, there came out this HOPE scheme. This HOPE scheme is a guarantee by the government instead of the insurance company. So the person can have a loan, and the government can guarantee up to 200,000. For the person. So we know many people who have some kind of disability who are finally in their 40s, 30s, who are finally buying their new homes, when before they had to pay rent or live in residential homes, for example. And now they're starting to buy their homes. There are those who are courageous enough or have enough time, energy, and money. More than money, I think it's combination, it's dynamics, it's creativity, who wants to own their professional personal company. Many of us come across as specialists, being impaired ourselves, so having some kind of impairment, we can offer the best possible solutions to those who have an impairment and those who do not. So yes, CRPD does promote social entrepreneurship, and we do have frequent discussions with stakeholders, such as I already mentioned, the central bank. We have also other entities who are into sports and other categories. We're not just fixed like in one place. We can promote it even further. Sometimes we find resistance from persons with disability themselves because they either don't join, don't want to discuss, don't want to be in a panel, don't want to be in workshops. But many times we do have success when we are creating, when we are creating like workshops to create an outline of what the people out there want, of what businessmen are doing who don't have disabilities, we could follow same patterns. We see what is lacking, why we're getting stuck. We see what can help us to be the same as any businessman, as any entrepreneur. I'm sure many people are very creative and they can, yes, they can have their own company or small business.
Thank you very much, Christine, and thank you, Blaine. Are there any closing comments from your end before we wrap up?
Nothing from me, thank you.
All right. I'd like to thank all present here tonight. It's been really nice. This is a topic we've researched on, and you know, it's quite new. I'd like to give a big thumbs up to Blaine. You were great today. And I also want to thank APS for this lovely initiative. This is Pride Month, and APS are really doing a very, very big effort and taking initiatives, both in training their employees and staff and spreading awareness out there. And I think we have a nice collaboration, and we are all also a CRPD helping them and not helping them, collaborating with them so they can better their service to be inclusive for everyone. Thank you, Leanne. Thank you, Jeremy. Thank you, everyone involved.
Thank you, Christine. And again, I'd like to thank everyone who joined us this evening and for this very interesting session. We'll be sending a feedback form, as we appreciate your valuable insights. The recording of today's session will be available on the bank's YouTube channel early next week. We look forward to seeing you at our next APS Talks. In the meantime, please follow our social media channels for the latest updates. Thank you, everyone, and good evening.